sometimes you just gotta stop and smell the roses. Today we're gonna be talking about the rose model. Hey guys, I'm Brianette from HowRadiologyWorks.com. We have bite-sized content for those interested in radiology, especially radiologic technologists. The rose model is not named after roses like this, but rather named after Albert Rose, who was one of the early researchers on the ability for our eye to see objects in a background of noise. And that's something that is really a good model to know about when we want to talk about seeing objects in medical images. So if that sounds interesting to you, click below on subscribe and then click on the little bell icon so you can get notified when we release new content. And we're starting now about the rose model in medical x-ray imaging.
A simple model for how the human visual system will interact with data that looks like this, where there's objects in a noisy background, and how those relate to the fact of how much contrast do those objects have from the background, how much noise is there, how large are they, how many photons are used, which would determine how much noise is there. So first, we want to talk about contrast and noise. So we've talked briefly in other posts also about contrast. So contrast is the signal level of a given region above the background. So for instance, if the signal here, for instance, if this was a CT image, and if the signal was, say, 20 Hounsfield units above the background of, say, 40 Hounsfield units, so if this was 60 Hounsfield units and this was 40 Hounsfield units, then the contrast would be 20 Hounsfield units in that case. And then the contrast to noise, like we talked about, is the ratio of that contrast level to the noise that's in the background here. So obviously, if there's more contrast and less noise, it's going to be easier to see. So if we just look at one area where we plant this, we say here the contrast is 3 here in these kind of arbitrary units. So we have the contrast of 3, and then if we go to noisier and noisier cases, we can say the contrast to noise ratio, we just take this level of contrast and then divide it by this level of noise. So if we go just across this table here, we can see that we're going to lower and lower contrast to noise ratio. So it becomes harder to visualize the structures. So right here, the contrast noise ratio is very high. You can see all these structures very easily. And if you really squint, you may be able to see the smallest structure, but it's definitely, we can see these structures here, but the smallest structure here is difficult to visualize. And all of these structures, by the way, they all have the same contrast in this case. So the contrast to noise ratio, then we go to lower contrast. So that's a contrast of 3. If we go to a contrast of 2, and then we do the same thing where we go across. Now it's basically impossible to visualize that small object in the noisy background when we go to our lowest contrast noise level. Finally, we have one more case where, again, we have the contrast additionally decreased, so now the contrast is 1, and then when we come here, it becomes even difficult. If you don't know where those objects are, it becomes even difficult to visualize any of the objects in this last case with a very low contrast to noise ratio. So what we learned just from this simple kind of tutorial of looking and empirically looking at these images, we learned that somehow there's a relationship between the contrast and our ability to visualize the object, right? And somehow there's also a relationship between the size of the object. So Albert Rose did a study in the 1940s and published what's called the Rose Model, where our visual system, the SNR of our visual system, goes like the contrast of the lesion, and then also like the square root of the area of the lesion here. So depending on the size, for smaller areas, for smaller contrast enhanced areas, you would need to have a larger contrast to have the same detectability. And then N is the number of photons that are used in this ideal model. It assumes a perfect detector with no blurring, no additional noise. And so you can see here, now, in this case, rather than having the same contrast in all these simulated lesions, so again, simulate lesions in a uniform background, rather than having the same contrast, now we have higher contrast in this smallest lesion. And then you can see now, as we go to these more noisy scenarios, so a lower contrast to noise ratio, because we're keeping the contrast fixed in these cases, and as we go to that more noisy scenario, you can see now our ability to visualize these objects is similar. So I can still visualize the small objects, even when I can visualize the kind of medium-sized objects, because we have a higher contrast within the objects. So the biggest takeaway here is a simple model, the simple ROSE model, again, goes like the contrast linearly, and then the square root of the area. So for instance, you know, the area of a circle goes like the radius squared. So we can think of the fact that because it goes like the radius squared, and then this is a square root, the ability to visualize things will go like the kind of linear dimension of the circle, so the radius of the circle. So that's at a high level what we really wanted to have the takeaway is the contrast is very important, and the area, and then the noise, which will be determined based on the number of photons and then based on the detector as well. In future lectures, we'll talk about a more sophisticated model, which has to do with the signal to noise ratio as a function of spatial frequency.
So now that you know about the ROSE model in medical imaging, would it be as sweet? Would it be as nice by any other name? I don't think so. Thanks for hanging around again. And for another video on signal to noise, which is related to what we just talked about, check out the next link.